Blackstone Audio presents The Business of Dying, The Complete Western Stories by Richard S. Wheeler. This book is read by Traber Burns and Pam Ward. Foreword. Long ago, I spent several years in rural Arizona near the Mexican border. I was between newspaper jobs and hoped to make a living with freelance writing. I soon discovered that the remote border area was populated by various eccentric and gaudy people who, for various reasons, chose to live as far as possible from civilization. Some were notable. One had been Jack Dempsey's trainer. His wife had been a Ziegfeld Follies chorus girl. Another was a successful screenwriter who kindly taught me how to write fiction. I owe my success to him. But most were simply people like me, looking for adventure in an obscure corner of the States. They all had stories. One, a rancher, had roped a mountain lion and lived to tell about it. Johnny Carson even invited him to talk about it. I heard plenty of stories during my sojourn there, many of them told by the people who lived on a guest ranch that bordered Mexico. One of the stories included here involved a crazy attempt to graft a small piece of Mexican territory to the United States. I witnessed that one. Eventually, I returned to civilization, but the stories stayed with me. And an odd thing was happening. They kept getting funnier. Every time I told one of those stories, the event seemed more comic. By the time I got to writing them down a few years ago, the stories had turned into comedy. I fictionalized the actual characters and events, and in the process added to the comedy. But even so, these stories were inherently funny, and that is how they appear here. In addition to the contemporary stories, I wrote historical ones. These were based on the usual research, largely gotten from books, but some of those became comic too. The result is this anthology, which is mostly humor, some of it bizarre. My favorite by far of the historical short stories is The Square Reporter. It is about a real person, William Wright, a reporter for the Territorial Enterprise in Virginia City, Nevada. He was a friend of Samuel Clemens, who also wrote for the paper. They were fierce rivals when it came to publishing the wildest and most outlandish hoaxes they could dream up. Wright, whose pen name was Dan DeQuill, was a master at the game and came up with what was probably the best hoax in the history of journalism. DeQuill's story was about an inventive sort who intended to cross Death Valley in the heat of summer, wearing a suit of armor that would protect him from the deadly sun. The armor would contain a thick layer of sponge, which would hold enough water to keep him cool and get him across the lethal valley. In that story, get this, the traveler freezes to death because the evaporation from the sponges cooled him too fast. It was widely reprinted and believed in reputable London papers and around the globe, while the newspeople in Nevada were enjoying the hoax. In my own story about William Wright, one of the major mining entrepreneurs, Jim Fair, asked him to descend into his sealed-off mine and observe what might be the biggest bonanza in the history of the Comstock lode, which he does, and you will find the result of all that within. Richard S. Wheeler. Mugs Birdsong's Crime Academy. Chapter 1. They handed Mugs Birdsong $2 and stuffed him into a cheap gray suit and escorted him to the gate of the Wyoming State Penitentiary that fine spring day. The warden, L.L. Grubbenheider, was beaming. "We'll be seeing you, Mugs," he said, offering the evicted con a hearty handshake. He knew what he was talking about. Mugs was the most famous criminal in the country. He was known from coast to coast, from Mexico to Canada. There was no crime he hadn't attempted, and no crime he wouldn't try. Mothers warned their daughters that when Mugs Birdsong was loose in the world, nothing was safe. Fathers warned their sons that they should not admire Mugs Birdsong, even though there were ballads written about him, and he had replaced Billy the Kid as the most celebrated crook in the universe. Mugs had gotten off easy this time, serving only 5 years. He was still a young man in his 40s, with a life ahead of him. He rarely was in prison for long. His technique was to stare at the juries, mesmerizing them, awakening terror in them, so they all returned verdicts he could live with. More than one juror reported that he feared for his life, the way Mugs was staring at him during the trial. Other jurors routinely begged judges to be excused from jury duty whenever there was a Mugs Birdsong trial. But the warden was correct. He'd be seeing Mugs again, probably sooner rather than later. Mugs didn't mind either way. The pen at Rollins was a noble and hospitable establishment, and life was just as fine inside as out. It was run by the Wyoming Board of Charities and Reform, which suited Mugs just fine. They had worked mightily at reforming him, and he had enjoyed it. But now he stood on the steps, not so much a free man, as one who had the annoying task of providing a living for himself. $2 would not last long. Being free was sometimes a pain in the ass. The air was chill, and his sleazy suit did not turn the cold. He stepped down to the road and wandered into a raw, high plains town that had no excuse to exist. Mostly it fed local ranchers and housed prison guards and was a whistle stop. Mugs Birdsong was on the loose, and dogs slinked away, tail between their legs, and shivering wives locked their front doors, and children stared from behind lilac bushes. The marvelous thing about Mugs was that he stole from the poor and gave to the rich. Mugs liked the town. No one in his right mind wanted to live in Rollins, which is why the town was juicy and pleasant to Mugs. He debated what to do. $2 wouldn't take him far, but that was no problem. It wouldn't buy him much hamburger, but that was no problem. Whatever he needed, he took. So there never was a problem in all of his life. He had taken fortunes from quivering financiers and candy from babies. And all his life, Mugs Birdsong had never had a problem clothing, feeding, or sheltering himself. Neither had he ever had a problem finding a mate. He simply took whatever was convenient, and that resolved the matter. He had made several ladies very happy, and one or two very sad. He stopped in at the local beanery, and the counter boy recognized him instantly, set a bowl of chili before the renowned criminal with trembling hand, and refused pay for it. That's how it was with Mugs. He never had any problems with life. He eyed the sleepy burg, looking for a saloon. It had been years since he had wet his whistle, and a foaming mug seemed a fine idea. Down the street, the Parsnip Saloon announced itself, so Mugs ambled that direction, entered through a double door, and found himself in a dank and gloomy interior that exuded strange odors. The pen was a better place. In the dim light, he discovered a barkeep with a soiled apron and an arm garter. "A mug of cold beer, that's what I need," Mugs said. "Show me your dime first," the keep said. Mugs laughed. "I got a $2 going away present right here, pal, and that buys a lot of—"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.